So far, we've been working to understand the atom, and we've also recently been understanding light better. In this lesson, we're going to combine those two. We're going to see how light interacts with the atom. Specifically, we're going to look at a model of the atom developed by Niels Bohr, which helps us understand the light that comes out of and goes into atoms. Remember at the beginning of the class when I told you that chemistry would allow us to figure out what the sun was made of? Well, in this lesson, we're going to take a look at how the Bohr model of the atom lets us do just that. So let's figure out what the sun is made of. Here, we're looking at three funny shaped lamps. These are just light bulbs, and each of these light bulbs has only one atom type in them. So this light bulb is full of hydrogen, and the light bulb in the middle is full of helium. And we see that they're different colors. The way these lamps work, much like lamps we use in our house, is you plug them into the wall, you have a positive side and a negative side, and electrons flow in. And as those electrons flow in, they cause these atoms to emit light. And what you'll notice is the different atoms cause different colors. So helium looks like this reddish orange color. Hydrogen looks like this light pink color. And on the far right, we actually have mercury gas. That's Hg, strangely. And it's this light blue color. So different atoms emit different colors. How can we explain that? That's what Niels Bohr set out to do. And he did it by saying two things about our atom. First, he said that electrons are in fixed rings. So this ring here has an electron in it, say. And normally the electron is in that first ring, by the way. And he said that the electrons in those rings can only be on those rings and not in between it. So the electron can be in that smaller ring, or it could be in this bigger ring, but it can't be anywhere between. So it's kind of like when you go to the mall and you can be on the first floor or the second floor, but you can't hang out on the 1.5 floor. That's what electrons are like around the atom. Electrons can move between these rings and cause light to either be emitted, that has come out, or actually it can work the other way and you can send light in and cause an electron to be absorbed. So that's what Niels Bohr said about the atom. An interesting fact about Niels Bohr is that he loved to play soccer with his brother growing up. Turns out his brother was way more gifted and ended up playing in the Olympics. Niels Bohr had to settle for just being a Nobel Prize winning scientist. Sad times. So how does this explain the emission of light? Well, when electrons drop from one ring to another, light is emitted. So here's what happens. Our electrons, remember, stream into our light bulb and they go onto the outer ring of hydrogen. And then what happens is they drop down. And when they drop down, they drop in energy. So the farther away they are from the center of the atom, the higher energy they are. It's kind of like, once again, if you're on the second story of that mall and you jump off, you would get a bunch of energy as you jump from one story to another. And that energy, where that goes to in the case of you jumping, is just you move quickly and then you break a bone, sad times. In this case, that energy goes to a much more productive end and makes light. So light comes out. So that's the way emission works. Electrons start in one ring and drop down, and that emits light. So really important to remember that. When an electron drops from one ring to another, light is emitted. The opposite process can also happen, and that's called absorption. Light is absorbed, and that makes electrons jump from one ring to another. So remember how I said electrons generally hang out in that lowest ring. In fact, the lamps are specially designed to make those electrons not there, and that's part of the way they work. Now that electron's in the lowest ring. And then let's say we have a light source. In this case, our light source is the sun. So say we have some hydrogen hanging out around the sun, which you would, because the sun turns out to be made of hydrogen. More on that later. And the light comes out of the sun, and it eventually hits our electron in that bottom ring. What happens is that light goes away. So we could just imagine getting rid of that light. And the electron hops up to that upper ring. And now the electron is no longer down in that lower ring. So it gets higher up on the rings. So when light is absorbed, electrons jump from one ring to another. Now you'll notice in these images, we've numbered these rings. So here's the N equals one level, and here's the N equals two level. And those are just names for the different floors. It's kind of like how we call things the first and second floor. Scientists sometimes not the most creative when it comes to naming. So we just named those N equals 1 and N equals 2. All right, so that's the absorption process. Now, it turns out, though, there's not just two rings, there's more. And we'll take a look at that in a little bit in our video. But first, let's think about this sun problem. How do we know what the sun is made of, and how does the Bohr model help us understand that? Well, when we think about light that comes from the sun, it pours out from the sun and eventually hits the Earth, and it carries with it a secret message. How does it do that? Well, we need to understand first that the light that comes from the sun looks like white light if we go out on a nice, clear, sunny day. And it is, but that actually contains all colors. And the way we know that is sometimes a special thing happens where we have water droplets in the air that split up the sunlight into all its colors from the rainbow. So we get all the colors of the rainbow there. If we take a really close look at the rainbow is missing colors. So if you take a close look at the rainbow, scientists can do this with an instrument called a spectrometer. They'll see these dark lines. So you see these dark lines right here? That's telling us there's no light there. So we should see this nice smooth spectrum all the way from red to violet. And instead we see gaps in our rainbow. What in the world is going on? Well, those gaps come from absorbed light. So the missing light tells us what the sun is made of. So for example, this line right here and this line right here come from light that's been absorbed by hydrogen. Remember, when that light's absorbed, it goes away. And that leaves a black line. Notice that actually looks like a similar color to our hydrogen emission lamp we looked at earlier, because every element has this characteristic wavelength that it absorbs and emits at. Here we see a helium absorption. And notice that's a similar color to our helium lamp. Again, every element has its own unique color signature, and this allows us to tell that the sun is made of hydrogen and helium. Now we see all these other missing lines, and those come from different elements. There's tons of different elements in the sun, but the main two turn out to be hydrogen and helium. And so the Bohr model helped us for the first time say, hey, we know what the sun is made of. Okay, last note here on the Bohr model. We've looked at it through this whole video with just two rings. In actuality, it has many rings. So you can see here we have the N equals one level, and then we have the N equals two level. We had drawn those before. Oh, but what do you know? There's another ring there, and that's N equals three. And then there's another ring there, and that's N equals four. So as we name these rings, they just get higher and higher in the numbers, okay? And notice that the gaps get smaller and smaller and smaller. And the exact spacing of those rings depends on the atom. And that's why the colors change. Okay, the last thing we're gonna do is we're just gonna look at these different transitions here, which we're going to be basically thinking about a spot the electron starts and a spot the electron ends, and decide if that's an absorption or an emission process. So we're going to identify each of these transitions as an absorption or an emission. So first, problem A says we go from N equals 1 to N equals 4. So that's like an electron starting out in our first ring and eventually going way out here to the fourth ring. That's the transition we're looking at. Well, does that take light? Or does it give off light? Remember, just like going upstairs takes energy, going farther away from the nucleus takes energy. So that's gonna be something that takes light, and that's an absorption process. So what we're gonna write there is absorption. Okay, so an absorption process, we'll see that the N value increases. So anytime the N value increases, that's an absorption process. On the other hand, if we see a decreasing N, that's an emission process. So with that in mind, let's take a look now at B. Okay, B says that we're going to be going from N equals 3 to N equals 4. That means we're starting here and we're just going up just a little, not much at all. Okay, so we just have this really small jump from there to right there. Okay, not much of a jump at all. And as you imagine, that doesn't take much energy. And so you start to see why there's different energies associated with all the different transitions from the different elements. So that once again is an uphill process. We're going from N equals 3 to N equals 4. And so it's similarly going to be absorption. Okay, let's like take a look at C. C tells us that we go from N equals 3, that's the third ring, to N equals 1, that's the first ring. Now we're dropping. Now remember, when we drop down, we're going to give off energy, just like a ball speeds up as we drop it from up high. And that means that it's an emission process. That energy is going to go to light, our N is decreasing, and we have an emission process. Light is emitted from that atom. So remember, whenever we have an emission process, our electron falls and light comes out. Okay, lastly, let's look at D. Here, we'll just look at the numbers. N goes from 7 to 9. So notice I don't even have the 7th and 9th ring drawn on there, but there are that many rings. We went from floor 7 to floor 9, and so that's gonna be an absorption process. We're going uphill. Okay, so that's how Niels Bohr explained the interaction of light and matter. In the next video, we're gonna take a look at calculating what wavelength of light might come out as these transitions happen. Hey, hey.